So hi guys, I welcome you to the series called RBI 24/7. Guys, as you all must be knowing that my name is Mansi Anand, and in this series we conduct a 5-question session. So guys, before moving to the question number 1, a little introduction about your mentor. So I have done my graduation from Sri Guru Gobind Singh College of Commerce, Delhi University, and after that I have done my post graduation from Delhi School of Economics. And after that, I have cleared JRF in Commerce and Management, right? So that was a brief introduction. And now, moving ahead to the customary thing for our session, that is, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are a new entrant here and you are watching our video for the very first time, then do not forget to hit the subscribe button. It can help you to stay in touch with us. And pressing this bell icon can help you to get notified whenever a new video comes up, right? After that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. And since we are talking about doubts, so guys, if you have any problem or any doubt in any question, you can comment on that video. And if there is a topic in which you're facing some problem or you're unable to understand it, then also you can post it on the video and we'll try to take it up in these sessions, right? So after that, so are you ready for question number 1? So here is your question number 1. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. So this question mentions some cases, right? And it asks you to select those cases out of these 3 in which there is a case of a willful defaulter, right? So to attempt this question, you should know the meaning to this word, to this phrase, willful defaulter, right? Moving ahead to the solution. So guys, you can pause the video here and you can analyze the 3 cases and then decide upon your answer, right? So we are moving to the solution here, and the solution says that the correct option is option E. So option E means one and 3. That means in case 1, there is a case of willful defaulter, and in case of 3, there is willful defaulter. So guys, the phrase in itself tells you the meaning, willful defaulter. Someone who is defaulting or someone who is not making a payment by his or her own will, right? So the situations are not forcing them to do so, but they have the capability to make the payment, but still they are not making it, then they are known as willful defaulter. So talking about case number 1, this case says that Virani Constructions took a loan from PN Bank for expansion projects. Now they have not paid their loan installments from past 6 months, but when the bank officials analyzed the financial records, they found sufficient evidence about company's capability to pay. So that means company can pay, it has the funds, it is in a good financial position, or at least in a position which is required for paying back its loans. But it is still not paying, right? So that is why there is a case of willful defaulter. After that, second case, it says Khanna Telecom had raised a loan from SBI to buy advanced equipment for the production of a new premium mobile phone that they wanted to launch. But production process was halted because of the COVID-induced lockdown, and hence they are facing financial distress. They are unable to pay back the loan as they start facing financial problems. So see, here they are not doing it by their own will. They are being forced by outer external circumstances. That is why this defaulter, Khanna Telecom, is not a willful defaulter. After that, case 3, it says that Gupta Estate Private Limited took a loan from Public Sector Bank for establishing a new factory, but used the money to pay back a previous loan without any intimation to the new lender. Now they are unable to pay back their installment. So guys, see, they are clearly mentioning that they wanted to raise a loan for establishing a new factory, and this is the premise on which the bank, the public sector bank, it gave Gupta Estates the loan. But now, see, they are turning back from their words. They told the bank that they are going to establish a new factory, but they used that money from the loan to pay back a previous loan. So basically, they did not use the money for the purpose for the purpose it was raised. So this would also count as a willful default, because they knew that they were going to do, they are doing something which is not right, or which is not, they were not forced by the circumstances, but they did it on their own or by their own will, right? So learning some more things about willful default. So willful defaulter is an entity who has not paid the loan amount despite its financial ability to repay it, right? And here are some situations which are considered as a willful default. First, when the unit has defaulted in meeting payment even after having the financial capacity to honor the obligations, right? Now point B, it says that when the unit has defaulted and has not utilized the credit facilities from the lender for the specific purposes for which the finance was raised, but has diverted the funds. So this is very important here, diverted the funds, which means put the funds to some other use without intimating their, without telling their new lender. So diverting the funds for other purposes, right? So without any intimation to their lender. After that, when the unit has defaulted, as it has siphoned off the funds and the funds are untraceable in the unit, that means they do not know. See, if there is a bank and it has lent some money to a company, the bank does not know that where the money went, and it is not visible in the books of that particular company, of that particular defaulter, that where did the funds go, right? So basically they are engaging into some accounting technique, or they are trying to cover it up with the help of some accounting loopholes, right? So siphoned off funds means there is no trace of that money in the unit. So siphoned off means diverting the funds to some other use, or basically covering it up with the help of accounting loopholes, or making some or doing some window dressing to the accounts, right? After that, D part, when the unit has defaulted in the meeting its payment repayment obligations and also disposed of or removed the movable assets or immovable property given for the purpose of securing the loan. That means if a company has taken a loan and it has put some collateral, right? Now the bank would think, okay, if they are not meeting my payments, let me take the collateral and sell it and let me raise money from it, right? But now the company has done something else also. They have removed the asset, or they have covered the collateral somehow so that the banks cannot use it. Let's say if they have put a building or a property as collateral, now the banks come to know that the company is not the real owner of that property, right? So basically disposed of the asset so that the lender now cannot sell that particular property which was put as collateral without the knowledge of lender, right? So these are some cases which trigger the case of willful defaulter. So guys, in recently there has been a case of willful default. It was mentioned in an article in Livement. Let's see who gives the correct answer about this willful defaulter, which was mentioned in the newspaper, right? So apart from that, guys, since we are talking about defaulters, there is a docu-series on Netflix which you can watch, Backward Bad Boys Billionaires. It covers some scams that happened in Indian economy, right? So it is going to give you some insight into how these scams happened, or what was the backdrop of it, right? So it covers some cases where some big companies had taken loans from public sector banks and they didn't return it, right? Moving ahead to question number 2. So here is your question number 2. This question says the dash is the tendency for the winning bid in an auction to exceed the intrinsic value or the true worth of an item. Moving ahead to the solution. The solution says the correct option is option B. Option B means winner's curse. So guys, have a look at this phrase which says a curse which is put on to a winner. So, for understanding that, let us first
Take an example. Let's say some auction is happening, and at this auction, a house, a beautiful house, is being sold. Now there is a person who really wants to buy this house, right? And there are other bidders as well. Now this person who, let's call him Mr. A, desperately wants to buy this house. So at the end of the auction, Mr. A succeeds in buying the house by putting the highest bid. But now when Mr. A examines the house properly, or when Mr. A shifts to that house, after that he realizes that the money that he paid for this house is not worth it, or he has paid too much for this particular asset. So he is the winner. Obviously, he has succeeded in acquiring the asset that he wanted to, but now he is realizing that he has paid too much money for an asset which is not that much worth, right? So this is known as winner's curse, when a person who wins the auction but later realizes that the item is not true, the item is not having that much worth for that the money has been paid, and exceeds, see, the winning bid, the amount that Mr. A paid for the house exceeds the intrinsic value of the house. Intrinsic value means the value which is being held by the house. And now Mr. A, if he wants to sell this house, it might not fetch him that much money that he paid, right? So this scene reminds me of an instance in a series. So if you have watched a web series called Inside Edge, which is based on cricket, so if you remember, in an episode in season 2 of the series, there was a high bid put up for a cricketer which no one was expecting, right? So there was a cricketer who was sold at eight to nine crores, right? So there you can see that the team who won that cricketer obviously ended up succeeding or ended up winning, but they bought that particular person, that particular player, at a very, very high amount that they did not expect, right? So that you can call it as a winner's curse, right? Moving ahead. Okay, winner's curse lead to example of buyer's remorse. So the buyer is actually regretting, wherein the buyer of something feels like they have overpaid in the retrospect. Theoretically, so why does it happen? So it happens because of the incomplete information. So in our previous example, let's say if Mr. A had some information that the house is not worth that much money that he was willing to pay, he might not have paid it, right? So the main reason here is lack of information. So some buyers have it and some bidders do not have it, right? So the main reason is lack of information. So in investing world, we can put this to use. This winner's curse can be put to use in case of IPOs or initial public offerings, when people out of the frenzy. So see, whenever a company comes up with an IPO, it is somehow like an auction, because they are inviting bids from people to buy their shares or to buy a stake or ownership in their own firm, right? So it is similar to an auction, right? So there can be many buyers who buy the shares in IPOs at higher prices, and they are allotted at very high prices, but they are not able to sell those shares later at that much high price, right? So it can lead to remorse or it can lead to regret, right? So this is winner's curse. And recently the Nobel Prize winners in economics, the research that they were doing, it somehow relates to this also, right? So you can mention their names in the comments below. So I'll be waiting for your comments, right? Moving ahead to question number 3 for today. Okay, before moving to question number 3, you can have a look at this picture. Moving ahead. So here is your question number 3, which says, select the correct statement about Friedman's doctrine. So let's see what the correct option is. The correct option is A. A means, according to Friedman. So here Friedman talks about Milton Friedman. You must have heard about him. very famous personality in the economics and finance world. The only business of the business is to do business and make money, right? So basically he says that the businesses, their only responsibility is to satisfy their shareholders or maximize the wealth of their shareholders, right? So guys, this was put up into an article by Milton in 1970s, and it got really popular because it talked about how businesses, they do not need to worry about the impact of their actions on the society. So today we talk about corporate governance. We talk that how businesses, whatever they do, it impacts the society around them. It impacts the people surrounding it, right? Or the stakeholders surrounding it. But this was way back, and currently there is, you can witness much criticism of this, that how many experts say that businesses do need to be socially responsible. But this theory, this concept, it says that businesses need not be socially responsible. It is not their job, because the job of the managers of a business is to earn money or to increase the wealth of their shareholders, because shareholders are the owners. They have put their money into business and expect it to multiply, right? So guys, you can find this particular article that was written in 1970s easily if you Google it, right? So you can read it to have if you like reading about such stuff, so you can give it a read and understand what was written according to that time, right? So here you can see, it is also called shareholder theory, relates to business ethics. As per this theory, objective of the company should be to maximize the return of shareholders, and only business of the business is to do business and make money. So Milton was an Milton Friedman, an American economist, came up with this theory in 1970. Friedman argues that executives are merely employees of the owners. So that is why they need to work for the benefit of owners. Those are the shareholders, right? So they must provide quality service to their owners. Moreover, shareholders are the owners of the company, and they should work to satisfy their shareholders. So as per this theory, a company has no social responsibility unless the shareholders decide so. So if the owners of the company want, they can be socially responsible, but it is not necessary, right? Because businesses, their main motive is to add to their shareholders or their owners' wealth, right? So a simple concept, moving ahead. Okay, so this question says, which policy leaves a side effect on government budget or borrowing? A very simple question about different policies. So guys, the correct option for this question is option A. So option A means fiscal policy. So let us try to understand the difference between fiscal and monetary policy. Here you can see, very simple. Fiscal policy, it is the taxation and expenditure policy by government, right? Whereas the monetary policy undertaken by monetary authorities such as central banks, it covers the interest rates. Basically, it covers the interest rate, or they affect such factors which affect monetary supply or money supply in the economy. Here you can see. So basically, fiscal policy decided by government, change in government spending, that is expenditure or tax rate. So no specific target, and it has the side effect on government budget and borrowing. Why is it so? Because see, if government is spending some money, or if it is collecting taxes, that is adding or getting subtracted from government's budget. That is why this is the policy which affects government budget, right? Strong political dimensions, obviously, because government is involved, that is why political dimensions attach to changing these factors. Whereas coming to the monetary policy, changes in interest rate, money supply, usually set by a central bank, target inflation. After that, side effect on exchange rate and housing market. Right?
So, interest rates, they try to generate or they try to tamper with the lending activity in the economy.
Mostly independent from the political process because it is being set up by central bank. Right? So, very simple question. Moving ahead to the last question for today, and here is the last question, which says the government of a country A plans to cut out foreign competition in pharmaceuticals industry. After that, it is planning to put up a complete ban on raw materials or APIs which are imported from a neighboring country B at cheaper prices. What could be one of the after effects of this move? So guys, you can pause the video and read the options carefully. Moving ahead to the solution. And the solution says that the correct option is option D. Option D means it would lead to a creation of monopoly market for APIs in country A. See, country A's government is trying to cut out on imports, right? So that means they are trying to boost the domestic industry for the products which are being imported. Here, those products are APIs or active pharmaceutical ingredients, right? But this upliftment of the domestic industry cannot happen in short term or cannot happen in one day. That is why it is going to take time to establish new industries belonging to the same sector. And if in that time government plans to put up a complete ban on imports from neighboring country B, then in that case, whichever firms are present in the domestic country or country A, they are going to raise the prices of their products and they will try to capitalize on the monopoly situation. So in country A, there can be a situation of monopoly which can be created, right? We cannot say about country B, but yes, there is going to be a monopoly market in country A. So guys, this is taken from a current news in which this is the same problem having, and the country A, it is India, and country B is China. So as you know, government is trying to cut out the dependence of Indian industries on Chinese imports, right? But that is leading to creation of monopolies in Indian market because producers cannot import at cheaper prices from neighboring country, but they will have to buy here, right? So, and putting up of new units for APIs takes up time, right? So this is going to lead to creation of monopoly. Here you can see, as I told you, trying to reduce India's dependence on China may lead to supply constraints and increased prices if left unchecked. So government would have to check the prices, otherwise there can be some situations like monopoly which can be created. Smaller companies may become near monopolies and charge higher prices, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then do not forget to give us a thumbs up, because I'll be back in next session giving up some new information. Until then, you take care of your health and do not forget to answer the questions which I have asked in this session. And I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.